Hello, Juliana.
And you are?
Lydia.
Lydia, I don't think we've met.
No.
You've just arrived.
Yes.
That's your boat, offshore?
Yes.
It's a big boat.
Well, it belongs to my family.
So you've come for the weekend?
Yes. Oh yes, at least.
You're friends of my sister.
Your sister?
My uncle.
Your uncle.
I don't mean to be rude, but who was it invited you?
Invited us?
You mean you didn't come to the party? You're not a guest?
Oh, you mean this is your home? I'm in your home.
Yes, well, it's my uncle's house.
It's so big I thought it was a hotel.
We have a big family.
I'm sorry, I just thought...
It's okay. Where do you come from?
Greece.
Greece. You mean just now?
Yes. My sisters and I, we were to be married to our cousins, and well, we didn't want to, but we had to, so when the wedding day came, we just got on our boat and left, so here we are.
Just like that?
Yes.
Just walked away from the altar and sailed away from Greece?
Yes. Where are we?
Italy. This is Italy.
Oh, Italy, I love Italy.
Well, yes, so do I. And your sisters, they're still on the boat?
Yes, we came, at least some of us came ashore. There are 50 of us all together.
15?
50. 50 sisters?
I don't think even I know anyone who has 50 sisters. And you were all to be married to your cousins?
Yes!
To your cousins?
Yes! We're looking for asylum. We want to be taken in here so we don't have to marry our cousins.
You want to be taken in as immigrants?
As refugees.
Refugees?
Yes.
From?
From Greece.
I mean, you know, from political oppression or war.
Or kidnapping or rape?
From rape.
By our cousins.
Well, marriage, really.
Not if we can help it.
I see.
You seem like a good person, Juliana. We need your help.
I think you should talk to my uncle, Piero. He has connections. Just stay here. If you'll wait here, I'll bring him out.
Thank you.
So, this is your wedding day?
No.
You are trying on your dresses because your wedding day is coming soon.
No.
No, we're not getting married.
Oh, you have been married already.
No. So, it's none of my business. But I can tell you, marriage is a wonderful thing. Be married, right?
No husbands at your age. Children, when I was your age, I already had 3 sons. Now I have 13 sons.
13 sons.
My oldest, that's Pierre. He stays home here with his mother, a good boy. But too old for you.
Actually, we were hoping to meet Pierre.
My second son, Paolo. He lives just next door. A doctor. He takes good care of the people here. Also Mary, 5 children. Paolo is Giuliano's father. You met Giuliano?
Yes, and he said we might be able to.
My third son. He is in business here in town. He visits me every week, every Sunday without fail. Also Mary, 5 children. A good boy.
Excuse me, but is
my
there any...
My fourth son. He was a sweet child. Cherubic, such little cheek, such a sunny disposition. Oh! He joined the church. My fifth. He was also in business here in town. But then he got involved with certain business associates. My sixth son. He's married to a German girl. My seventh son. He went to America. To his younger brother. And then 3 years later, they sent for their younger brother Guido, and he went to America too. My tenth son. He became a politician.
Excuse me, but
my 11th son. Well, he is on a television, on a soap opera with the stories of the love affairs and God knows what not. He's not killing people. My 12th son, he is not killing anybody either, but he has his love affairs. He argues all the time with his wife, Frita, like a tramp. Always spends his money going here and there for soccer games. A good man is hard to find.
That's so true.
Still, he is always getting into fights, so he comes home in the middle of the night. Nobody's a perfect. He loves his children.
That's a good thing.
My youngest son, he likes to ride the motorcycles. He likes to be in Roma with the young movie actresses and the parties. He's my baby.
I see.
So, what do I have left? Now you see why I love my Piero so much and want to protect him, my firstborn, who is too old for you. Are you staying for dinner?
We haven't been invited.
Oh, Piero! Piero, you should invite them for dinner.
They're good girls.
I never had daughters. Never had that.
Giuliano, mi dispiace ma...
Sì, sì, fa niente.
Could I offer you something?
No, thank you.
A glass of wine?
No, thank you.
Coffee, tea?
No, thanks.
Something to eat?
Actually, I don't know how to say this. I don't want to complain. But you don't seem to have a lot of products.
Products?
Soaps, you know, and creams. Things like Olympia. You know, we've been traveling, and when you've been traveling, you hope at the end of the journey you might find some, like, oil of Olay moisturizing body wash. Or like John Frieda's sheer blonde shampoo and conditioner for highlighted blondes.
Olympia!
I know you're not a hotel, so you wouldn't have everything, but maybe some, like, Estee Lauder 24 karat golden body cream with love, or like Fetish Go Glitter Body Art in Soiree.
Olympia!
Max with Blossom Pink Poodle, prescriptive uplift under eye cream. Just some things to make a girl feel fresh.
Olympia!
I don't know about these things, but I'll ask Giuliana to go ahead and see me.
Really?
Thank you.
We were mostly hoping to ask you to just take us in.
Take you in?
Your nephew Giuliano said you have some connections?
Yes.
And that you can help us?
Well, this is a country where people know one another, and Giuliano's right. Sometimes these connections can be useful. If, for example, you were a member of my family, I'd certainly take you in, but I don't know you.
Oh, but we are related. I mean, you know, in some way, our people came from Greece to Sicily a long time ago, and to Syracuse, and from Syracuse to Taormina, and to the Golfo di Santa Eufemia, and from there up the coast of Italy to where we are now. So we are probably members of the same family, you and I.
Descended from Zeus, you mean?
Yes!
We're all sort of goddesses, in a way.
Indeed. It's very enticing to recover an old family connection to Zeus. And where's your father, meanwhile? Is he not able to take care of you?
Our father signed a wedding contract to give us away.
Your cousins from Greece.
From America. They went from Greece to America, and now they're rich and think they can do whatever they want with us.
And the courts in your country, they would enforce such a contract?
It's an old contract. It seems they will. We have nothing against men.
Not all of us.
But what these men have in mind is not usual.
Or else all too usual.
Well, as it happens, I have some house guests for the weekend, and I'd be delighted if you could all join us for dinner, stay the night if you like until you get your bearings, but really, as for the difficulties you find yourselves in, disagreeable as they are, and as much as I'd like to help, this really isn't any of my business.
Whose business is it if not yours? You're a human being.
And a relative.
This is a crisis!
And yet, you know I'm not the Red Cross.
And so?
So, to be frank, I can't take in every refugee who comes into my garden.
Why not?
Because then I'd have a refugee camp here in my house. I'd have a house full of Afghans and Kosovars and Eritreans, boat people from Syria and God knows what all.
That sounds nice.
I don't think I can open my doors to the whole world.
Look at you, you're a rich person.
Well, what if I were to tell you, yes, I can do my part. In fact, I'm not a bad person entirely. Some people even call me a generous person. And I can help. But why should I help you? Shouldn't I look around the world and say, no, not these people, perhaps, but someone else has a better claim on my attention?
But we are here.
So?
We are here on your terrace. Why do you look for someone else? Look for someone else, too, if you would like, but we are here.
And yet, I know nothing of this dispute. I don't know whether these fellows have some rights, too. What should I do if they come to me and say, you've abducted our women? Give us our women or we'll shoot you.
Shoot you?
What do I know? I put myself on the line knowing nothing. Also, the life of my nephew, my brother next door, my brother's sons. I put their lives on the line for what? To save you, whom I've never met before. I don't know what this is. Why should I do this?
Because it's right.
I understand that it may be right, but one doesn't always go around doing what's right. I've never heard of such a thing. The world's a complicated place.
It's not that no one's ever said no to me before. But I don't think I've ever asked a man to save me in a situation like this and had him say no.
There's only one question to ask. Do we want to marry them or not? No, we don't. Are you going to let them come to your house and drag us away from here? Think of it this way. If you don't help us out, my sisters and I will hang ourselves off your front terrace. 50 dead women hanging off your house.
Hang yourselves.
What choice do we have?
Shall we ask your mother what she thinks would be right?
You're right, of course. Of course I'll take you, and I don't know what I was thinking. I beg your pardon, really. I wasn't quite absorbing what you were saying. I'll tell my mother. You'll stay for dinner, and then we'll talk and see what's to be done. Please make yourselves at home, and if there's anything at all you want, please ask.
Now you see, there are some men who are kind and decent.
Not so kind and decent if he isn't threatened by some scandal of dead women hanging off his house.
I liked him. You should give a person the benefit of the doubt.
You think you found this man's good side? Men don't have a good side.
I've known men who have a good side, Fiona.
I've known men you could sit with after dinner in front of the fireplace and just listen to the way he speaks and hear the gentleness in his way of speaking and the carefulness.
You can hear the strength in it, and you can know that you're safe. I've known men who think, oh, a woman, I'd like to take care of her. And not in any way that he feels he's superior and has control, but in a way that he understands.
A woman is a different sort of person, and special because of that. Precious because of that, and vulnerable because of that, in ways that he isn't, although he might be vulnerable in his own ways because of his things that he has. But he thinks, if only I could be close to her and see what she sees and feel what she feels, how much richer my life would be. And so because of that, he thinks, oh, a woman. I can really respect her and love her for who she really is.
I know a man who will say, oh, I want to take care of you, because what he really means is he wants to get used to you for a while, and while he's using you, he's not knowing. Take you as though you were in his car right before he decides to trade you in.
I've known men like that too, but not all men are necessarily the same. Sometimes you can hear the whole man just in his voice, how deep it is, or how frightened. Where it stops to think, or how complex and subtle and sure it is.
You can hear the comfort in it and know that he'll protect you.
The male. The male is a biological accident, and an incomplete female, a half man, lump of flesh, trapped in a twilight zone somewhere between ape and human, constantly looking obsessively for some woman.
A little bit of any woman, because he thinks if he makes some connection with some woman, he'll be a whole human being, but he won't, he never will.
Yeah, boy, babies should be flushed down the toilet at birth.
I know how you feel, Fiona. I felt that way myself sometimes.
Still, this man who doesn't even know us, who owes us nothing, doesn't know what he risks by offering us a place to stay. There are places in this world where refugees are taken in out of generosity, and often it is men who do the taking in, because people have the capacity for goodness, and there could be worlds where people care for one another, nurture one another, honor one another's differences, and learn to live together in common justice, reconciling our differences in peaceful conversation and reaching out with goodwill towards one another. Where there's not a men's history and a separate women's history, but a human history, where we are all together and nurture one another, care for one another, not trying to put our down for not we are willing to understand, but instinctive pleasure in the enormous variety of creatures.
Lydia, why did you run away from us?
What?
We were waiting for you at the church.
You can't force us to marry you, Nikos.
Force you? We thought you were coming.
Why should we come?
Because we were getting married.
We never agreed to marry you.
We had a prenuptial agreement, Lydia.
We have a deal.
We never had a deal with you, Constantine.
Your father made a deal with my father before you were born, Fiona. You are engaged to me, and I am going to marry you.
Well, if there was some sort of misunderstanding...
There is no misunderstanding. We're not getting married to you.
There is a contract involved here.
My brothers and I, we've been waiting for this all our lives. And plus, it'd be pretty neat. I'm being married, 50 brides and 50 grooms. A real event.
And we never agreed to release you from your promise.
Why not?
Because I'm a traditional person, Fiona. I want a traditional marriage, a traditional wife. That's the way it is.
It's a different world now, Constantine. You can't just force someone to marry you because there's been some family agreement.
What do you think? You think you live in a world nowadays where you can throw in a promise just because you don't feel like keeping it? Just because drugs are rife, gambling is legal, medicine is euthanasia, birth is abortion, homosexuality is the norm, pornography is everybody's homes on the internet. Now you think you can do whatever you want, whenever you want to do it, no matter what the law might say. I don't accept that. Sometimes I like to lie down at night with my arms around someone and know she is there for me. Know this gives her pleasure. My arms around her, her back to me, my stomach pressed against her back, my face buried in her hair, one hand on her stomach, feeling at peace. That's what I want, to have that. I'll have my bride, if I have to have her, I'll have her back, to me. I'll have her back. What is it you women want? You want to be tied up with hoods and gags and blindfolds? You want to be stressed on an event with weights on your chest? You want me to pour gasoline on you and light you on fire? Is that what I have to do to keep you?
Lydia? Is this your wedding dress?
Yes.
Seems like you were ready to get married.
The future is going to happen, Fiona, whether you like it or not. You say you don't want to be taken against your will. People are taken against their will every day. Do you want to see tomorrow? Do you want to live in the future? Never mind. It doesn't matter. Tomorrow will take today by force, whether you like it or not. Time itself is an act of rape. Life is rape. No one asks to be born. No one asks to die. You make the best of it. You do what you have to do.
We have an uncle here, Constantine, and he's going to protect us.
I am an American now, Olympia. I am not afraid of your uncle. Do you watch television? Do you know what happens when Americans want something?
I am Piero. This is my home. And you'd be the cousins of these young women.
We were to be married.
I understand the women are no longer interested.
We are not here to negotiate.
That's a forthright position. I like to know where I stand when I deal with a man, but first let me welcome you properly. Why don't you come into the house with me and we'll have a glass of something. What's your favorite cigar? Do you like a Cuban? A Vegas Robina? A Partagas? Is it?
Constantine.
And you are?
Ed.
Nikos.
Nikos. Come with me. We'll have a glass of something, have a smoke, get things sorted out.
I'd like that.
Excuse me.
That bastard! What did I tell you?
He's going to solve it peacefully.
He's giving in, don't you get it? These men and their deals.
Right, you could be right. I don't think he would do that.
Sometimes a person can talk a good game, but when push comes to shove, they're weak right down to the core.
Except for Constantine.
And except for me, I haven't given in either. This game isn't over till someone lies on the ground with the flesh pulled off their bones. Men. You think you can do whatever you want with me? Think again. You think I'm so delicate? You think you have to take care of me? You throw me to the ground? You think I break? You think I can't get up again? You think I can't get up again? I don't need a man to save my life. Who needs a man? Who needs a man? These men can fuck themselves. These men are leeches. These men are parasites. These rapists. These politicians. These men with their men.
Of Barbies and Kens, and this ribbon would go with the whole ensemble so perfectly. This ensemble that I have, they are all arrayed with their hands up in the air because they're doing the firewalking ceremony.
And Barbie has on her pink feather boa and her lime green outfit with the flowers at the waist and the gold bow at the bodice. And Ken, Ken is doing the lambada. So of course they all have Mai Tais. And they're just having a wonderful time. And their convertible's parked nearby, so you know they could just take off to see the sunset at any time they want. And when people come over to see my collection, they just say, wow. Because they can't believe I've just done it. But I say, if that's who you are, you should just be who you are. Just do who you are, because if it's you, it can't be wrong. Some people, they like it rough, and if that's what they like, then that's okay. And if not, then not. It's not everyone's cup of tea. Everyone should be free to choose for themselves.
Plus, some of these things are nice. Can we keep them?
No, Olympia, not are getting married.
Maybe we should think about it. Some people go on honeymoons, too.
Olympia.
They go to places where there are white sands and hammocks, and people grab them by the waist and lift them up out of the water, splashing and laughing, and the sun sets, and people sip things through straws,
Olympia.
And listen to the waves, and even make love in the afternoon.
I think we're losing the point. Like, shouldn't we be leaving?
You don't think they'll follow us wherever we go?
Look, I have more presents. Are these things for you girls?
No, we're not accepting gifts.
Not accepting gifts.
Such a thing.
Oh, Juliana, these girls.
I suppose they're just nervous before wedding.
We are not nervous. It's like Fiona says, we don't want wedding presents.
Yet.
Don't. Don't say that. There are so few occasions when people give you things, and things are good.
A bottle of champagne, a good food.
A handsome man, a sunny day. Life's pleasures, you can't have too many, really.
When you are younger, you think nothing of it. But the older you get, the more you think, oh God, let me have more pleasure.
So take me away from this blessed earth and all its joys. A swim in the afternoon,
sex, a man with a nice nose, good pair of shoulders, eyes too.
Who are you?
I'm one of the house guests, dear. Guest of Piero, Eleanor.
And you're the brides.
Oh, we're still sort of thinking about it.
Oh, how exciting for Piero to be having a wedding here. To me, it just makes the perfect weekend.
I always say, you need to embrace love.
You need to let it in through every pore.
We come this way but once, this brief, brief time on Earth. You'll need to suck it in. The key thing is, you'll be wanting to let go of fear. Throw yourself into life. Take all your fears and pains and put them in a garbage can. And tie that to a yellow balloon filled with helium, and let it go. Love. Love touches. Love fondles. Love listens to its own needs.
What is it with you Italians? You spout this kind of bullshit when all you're ever really thinking is, oh, if I keep up this line of chatter, do I get to pinch someone's butt?
Isn't that the truth?
And if you smile, or simply return a look with a look, you find you've sealed your fate. You've fallen into life way over your head. Nothing is held back, like a Roman fountain or splash and burble, and you find yourself carried off, or even to walk through a crowd. You're in constant contact with all sorts of elbows and knees and soles and buttocks, all touching and rubbing everything that in another minute we'll all be naked. I just think everything is so shocking in Italy, and I'm not a Puritan. I mean, of course I am a Puritan, but that's not what I love about Italy. Because here, I am not a Puritan. I am alive. I love life. I take it in. It's tomatoes, it's sunshine.
It's olive oil.
It's paintings, it's men.
Everything is as though a giant mother was squashing you to her breast.
In Italy, to go out is to come home.
I'd like to take it in. I wouldn't mind, like, going swimming, even. Plus, guys, I don't have a problem with guys.
I don't have a problem with guys, either. This isn't about sunshine and olive oil. This is about guys hauling you off to their caves.
I think, for me, there's nothing quite like it when, you know, a person is attracted to you, and you look into their eyes and can see your own reflection through the tears of joy in their eyes.
the way you've always wanted to see yourself, but never have since you were a child.
Just sharing the daily things with another person, and I know that he loves me. Hugging me all day, treating me as though I were precious.
You are a twit!
Not?
I'll tell you something, Olympia. You're the kind of person who gets caught in the bottom of a ravine somewhere with their underpants over their head. I'm trying to save your neck and you don't even get it.
What did I say wrong?
Do you think I like feeling this way? Do you think it feels good to feel bad all the time? Do you think I wouldn't just like to be a nice, happy, well-adjusted person who can just take it as it is? But I can't just not be honest. And do you think that makes me happy to spend my entire life on Earth, the only life I'm ever gonna have, feeling angry?
Fiona!
Come, dears, let's leave them alone.
I'm sorry for the way Constantine seemed a little rude.
Well, I shouldn't put it all on him. I'm sorry for the way that we've behaved.
Thank you for saying so, Nikos.
I've always liked you, Lydia. Seeing you with your sisters, sometimes in the summers when our families would get together at the beach. I thought you were fun and funny and really good at volleyball. Which I thought showed you have a natural grace and beauty and a lot of energy.
Oh?
And it's not that I thought I fell in love with you at the time, or that I've been like some stalker in the background or something all these years.
No, I never...
But really, over the years, I've thought back from time to time how good it felt just to be around you.
Oh?
And so I thought maybe this would be an okay way to have a marriage.
Marriage?
To start out, not in a romantic way, but as a friendship.
Oh?
Because I admire you, and I think perhaps it could grow into something deeper and longer lasting.
Oh?
But maybe this isn't the thing you want, and I really don't want to force myself on you. I mean, you should be free to choose, obviously.
Thank you.
But I think I should say that what started out as a friendship and a sort of distant, even inattentive regard has grown into a passion already.
A passion.
I don't know how or when or where it began, but the more I felt this admiration and, well, pleasure in you.
Pleasure.
Seeing you become the person you are, I think a thoughtful person and smart, and it seems to me funny and warm.
Funny?
And passionate. I mean about the things I heard you talk about in school, a movie or playing the piano. I saw you one night at a cafe by the harbor, and I saw that happiness made you raucous. And I, for one, don't want to have a relationship that's cool or distant. I want a love that's all-consuming, that really consumes my whole life.
Your whole life.
And the longer the sense of you has lived with me, the more it has grown into a longing for you. So I wish you'd consider, perhaps not marriage, because it's true you hardly even know me, but a kind of courtship.
A courtship.
Or maybe we could just go sailing or see a movie or something.
Jeannie, Gus, you seem to talk a lot.
I do that sometimes. I get started on a sentence and then it leads to another sentence, and before I know it, I'm just trying to work it through the logic of it, trying to follow it through the end, because I think if I stop, if I don't get through to the end of what I'm saying before somebody interrupts me, then they won't understand what I'm saying. And what I'm saying isn't necessarily wrong. Might be. Not necessarily, it is. I'm glad to be corrected. But I can't get interrupted, or else I'll get confused and I won't know how to get back to the end of what I was saying.
I understand.
And I think sometimes I scare people because of it. They think I'm like so determined, just barging ahead, not really a sensitive person. Whereas, in truth, I am.
I know. Do you know about dreams?
Well, I have dreams.
But do you know what they mean?
I don't know. Maybe.
I had this dream that I was going to a wedding of these old friends of mine, and part of the wedding, a sort of event, was this enormous pond that they had built. And I was late getting to the wedding, so I got someone to airlift me in, and I dove into the pool, but when I landed in the water, the walls of the pond collapsed, and it all drained out, and 1,500 fish died, and
Everyone was looking for survivors, and then this 25-story high tidal wave came and crashed over me and sent me flying over a bridge, and then I was just completely alone in the middle of the ocean until I realized I had a cell phone tucked into my pocket, so I phoned Olivia to come and get me. And she said, oh, perfect, I'll send Japan, which is the name of her dog. I'll send Japan, and then would you take her for a walk and leave the car and found me? What do you think of that?
Well, I think things happen so suddenly sometimes.
Sometimes people don't want to fall in love. Because when you fall in love, it's too late to set conditions. You can't say, I love you if you do this, or I love you if you change that, because you can't help yourself. And then you have to live with whoever it is you fall in love with, however they are, and just put up with all the difficulties you've made for yourself, because true love has no conditions. And that's why it's so awful to fall in love. What would you like to do with me?
Well, I'd like to kiss you.
Kiss you, but I don't even know you.
Well, if you kiss me, then you'd know me.
People think it's hard to be a woman, but it's not easy to be a man. The expectations people have that a man should be a civilized person. Of course, I think everyone should be civilized, men and women both. But when push comes to shove, say you have some bad people who are invading your country, raping your own wives and daughters. Now we see this happens all the time, all around the world. And then a person wants a man who can defend his home. You can say, yes, it was men who started this. There's no such thing as good guys and bad guys, only guys. And they kill people. But if you are a man who doesn't want to be a bad guy, and you try not to be a bad guy, then it doesn't matter. Because when push comes to shove, and people need defending,
then no one wants a good guy anymore. Then a person wants a man who can fuck someone up, twist no bonds his blood, hot, howling up the bank, raging his heart, screaming with every urge, a vomit, a ground moving beneath his feet, the earth alive with laughter, the cries hammering in his heart, that take the motives turned loose with no brakes left to hold them. This noxious wild! And then, suddenly, when his impulse isn't called for any longer, a man is expected to put it away, carry on with life, as though he never had such impulses, or to know that if he does, he is a despicable person. So it may be that when a man turns this violence on a woman, in her bedroom or in the midst of war, slamming her down, hitting her, he should be esteemed for this, for informing her of what civilization really contains. The impulse to hurt, side by side with the gentleness, the use of force, as well as tenderness, the presence of coercion and necessity. For it has just been a luxury for her, really, not to have to act on these impulses, or even feel it, so she can stand aside and deplore it. Whereas in reality, it is an inextricable part of the civilization in which she lives, on which she depends. And so, when a man turns it against her, he's showing her a different sort of civilized behavior, really. One that she should know and feel as intimately as he does. To know it is part not just of him, but also of her life. Because to know this is to know the whole of life. Not just some pretty piece of it. This is a gift that a man can give a woman.
Does it have candles?
No, dear, no. Usually we have a little bride and little groom on top, but this time we will need 50 little brides and 50 little grooms, so we will have them all around on all the different tiers. It'll be like a huge party, like a carnival.
I would like candles.
Oh, candles, you want candles? Yes, of course not. Think nothing of it. You'll have candles if you want them.
What are you doing with this cake, Olympia? We don't need a cake.
Did someone order a cake?
It was delivered to the house.
I thought there were some conversations to be had.
What's going on?
Things seem to be moving awfully fast.
I ordered the cake. Thank you, Eleanor.
Anytime, dear. I'm just going to go get some candles for the cake.
So you gave in to them, didn't you?
I thought I could strike an accommodation with your cousins.
An accommodation?
The world I come from, it's not always all or nothing. Men learn to compromise all the time, after all. We have to go on living in the same world together.
So you wake up every morning and say, what compromises can I make today? Surely there's a sociopath somewhere who wants to make a deal.
Frankly, I see why you wouldn't want to accept the proposal of your cousins, 50 brides for 50 grooms in its entirety. But it seemed to me this young man, Nikos, wasn't such a bad man after all.
They're all the same, just different
names. And I thought there might be one or two others like Nikos, and if one were to find them, there might be some room to negotiate.
To negotiate?
To see if there may be one or two natural alliances.
I'd like to love the person I'm going to marry.
Yes, we all would, to be sure. Sometimes we do at first. Sometimes it lasts quite a bit.
I've known people who have loved one another all their lives.
I do, too. And yet it's very rare. And for the rest of us, we may do.
Maybe some of us don't want to get married at all.
I thought that could be an option too, and yet, for some of you, having a family is something you might long for as much as I do. To be close to another human being for the rest of your lives, and to the children you have together, coming through the pleasures and pains through all the years, that bring you closer together, closer to knowing the deepest truth of life, that life is nothing for us, but an experience we share with others. And if we want our experience of life to be deep and passionate, to have a sense of its unfolding over many years, to be in touch with the whole of it as we grow old, a lifelong marriage some of us will welcome.
What are you saying?
It seemed to me you might say to these fellows, look, the deal as a whole isn't good, but we'll take a 50% of your 10%.
What?
Of the 50 of you young women, I felt sure there may be some who still wish to be married to these young men.
Take 50%, take 10%, what is this, some sort of package deal?
Is Nikos a part of this?
What about Constantine? Is he a part of this deal or not? Am I a part of this deal?
We didn't get that far.
Didn't get that far? How long does it take to get that far? These men think they can do anything.
I don't hate men, Theona. In fact, I kind of like them.
So
maybe you think I shouldn't play their game, but I think I'm not a helpless victim. And when I put on a short skirt or paint my nails or dye my hair, I don't think I'm a twit. I think men know what I'm doing and they think it's fun and I think it's fun too. And I think we're equals in the game we play.
I wouldn't mind some sort of negotiation. We don't accept your deal. You can tell these men we don't accept it. What we would accept is if these men lied, they can come to us one by one and beg us to marry them. Give us time to think about it when we are on our own grounds. Postpone the wedding date. Let us consider and reconsider. Let us think about it when we are strong and they are weak. And let us go to them one by one and say freely if we want to marry them. Otherwise, there's nothing to be said.
But...
nothing. We reject your offer.
Fiona,
I speak for all of us.
Fiona.
I'm sorry to tell you what I've been saying, but this is only the accommodation I was trying to work out. In fact, Constantine won't have it either, and he speaks for all of your cousins. Your cousins will marry you whether you want to marry them or not. None of you has a choice.
And Nikos, what did Nikos have to say?
He let his brother speak for him.
Oh, isn't this just what I said?
Yes. Well, thank God we were lucky enough to come here. Thank God we found you.
I wish, in fact, you found someone else because I can't protect you. I can't put my home at risk, my home and my family, my nephew, the daughters of my brother. I'm sorry, I can't do it. For me, there never was a choice. The wedding will take place today. The arrangements have been made.
Who am I supposed to marry then? This is no different than it would be if we were lying in our beds and soldiers came in through the door and took whoever it was they wanted. I'm not going to do this.
What else can you do? What else can you do when your father won't protect you, your country won't defend you, you flee to another country and no one there will take care of you? What is left? Nothing, except to take care of yourself. We have no country now. We have become our own country where we make the laws ourselves.
Right.
Right.
And when these men take us to bed on our wedding nights, these men who left us no alternative, these men who forced themselves on us, we will need force with force, and we will kill them one by one.
Kill them?
What?
We can't kill them. Kill them? Are you crazy?
Would you kill them if they were soldiers coming through your bedroom door?
Of course I would, but kill them?
We can't kill them. None of these men are good.
How can you say that?
Here's how you can tell. Not one of them stood up against Constantine. Not one of them challenged him and said, "No, Constantine, let's take this deal, or let's at least negotiate. Let's see if maybe one or two of these sisters wants to marry us and let the rest go free. Let those go free who don't want to marry." No. Not one of them stood up against him. All his brothers were his silent partners. Would you want to be with someone who just can't stand like this? Would you ever feel safe with someone as weak as this?
No.
They've all gone along with it. They've made their decision. The only question left to ask is, will you defend yourself and will you defend your sisters?
Lydia? Lydia.
Yes.
Olympia.
Yes.
We have a pact, then. Not one groom will live through his wedding night. Are we agreed?
Yes.
Yes. I'm
going to help you girls get dressed for the wedding.
Sliding down the hill.
Nothing seems to be working out.
I was hoping for a wedding dress from a new Lulier.
But back home in Greece, all I could find was an Albino Galetta. Not even a Vera wedding.
And I've been hoping all my life, or at least most of it, for something with little spaghetti straps and lace right at the bodice and little lace flowers right where the straps met the bodice.
And people said, sometimes you have to settle.
But I don't want to. I don't think I have to settle, and I don't see why, at least on my wedding day, I can't have everything exactly the way I want.
Never mind, dear. You're going to love the way you look by the time we're finished.
My, what lovely faces you all have. I think myself, if I had such complexion, I'd have been married 7 times by now.
Probably this is how it feels to be drowning.
Now I suppose you might be saying to yourselves, before we make the final decision, let's ask ourselves, do we have similar backgrounds? Do we have real religious beliefs? Do we have similar ideas and standards and tastes? Are we real friends? Do we have a true happiness in being together, talking or just doing nothing together? Do we have a feeling of impaired unity?
Oh!
Giuliano, mi dispiace ma...
Sì, sì. Lasci a me.
Piero, you should have stopped this.
What could I have done?
Piero.
Lydia? Lydia, who is that with you?
This is Nikos, my husband.
Your husband?
Yes.
You didn't kill him?
I love him, Liam.
You broke your word?
I couldn't do it.
We all agreed what we were going to do.
I love him, Theo.
You love him?
I'm sorry, I couldn't help myself.
You go behind our backs. You betray your sisters, you break your promise, and you're sorry? In any other country, you would be put on trial for what you did and hanged, probably, or electrocuted!
Now, let's just stop where we are.
We are not finished.
Let's slow things down then, everyone. Deserves a fair trial, after all.
Oh, okay, all right. We'll put Lydia on trial, and we will be the jury.
And I will be the judge.
The judge.
You? Yes, you want to put it in the hands of some judge chosen by the business associate of your brother?
No.
I will be the judge. Is that okay with you?
Yes, good, I agree to that.
I agree to that, too.
All right, all right. Betrayal is the charge. What Lydia did in any other country would be treason.
I love him. I have nothing else to say.
Olivia, how could you just kill someone? You're just a girl.
I was confused.
How could you be confused?
I thought you said it was a good idea, Lydia, remember?
You agreed.
I had to agree with it the way Fiona put it, but if we live in a world where it is not possible to love another, then I don't want to live.
Oh, talk of love.
In the real world, if there's no justice, there can be no love, because there can be no love that is not freely offered, and it cannot be free unless every person has equal standing. First comes justice. And if there's no justice, then those who are being taken advantage of have every right to take their oppressors, to take those who stand in their way and drive them across the field like frightened horses, to set fire to their houses, to ruin everything that comes to hand, to hurl their corpses into wells. Where once there were houses, to leave rubble, smoldering wood piles, shattered stones, empty streets, silence, no living things, no birds, no dogs, and children. Not one stone left standing on another, but rather an entire wilderness of stones. And see if maybe then a lesson has been learned, because there are times, and though you may not like it, when this is justified, when this is all that human beings can rightfully do. And to shrink from that is to be less than human.
You know, everything you say may be right, Fiona, but if it is, I have to ask myself, then why doesn't it feel good? I have to go on my gut instincts, because sometimes you can convince yourself in your mind about the rightness of a thing, and you try to find fault in your reason, but you can't, because no matter how you turn it over in your mind, it comes out right, so you think, I know it's right, but I don't think it is, or I think it's right, but I know it isn't, and you can end up thinking, you're just a moron, or some sort of deficient sort of thing, but really, there are some things that when you want to know the truth of them, you have to use not just your mind, or even your mind and your feelings, but your cells, or your neurons, or something. Because they have to be considered in some larger way, and in the largest way of all. I know I have to go with my whole being when it says that I love him and he loves me, and nothing else matters, even if other things do matter, even if they matter quite a lot, even if we're doing this in the midst of everyone getting killed, I can't help it.
think I should. Probably this is how people end up marrying Nazis or whatever, but I can't help it.
You should.
I couldn't.
Lydia, if I'd known it was okay to do what you did, I might have loved someone too. I know everyone says this, but the truth is, I was just following orders in a way. I should kill myself probably now that I know the kind of person I am.
That's enough now. That's enough. I am ready with my verdict. This is what I have to say. You did a dreadful thing, you women, when you killed these men. What could be worse than to take another's life? And yet, you came to us, to my family and to me, to help you, and we failed you. We share the blame with you. What else could you have done, you women? You made your own laws because you had no others to protect you. This was your social contract. And Lydia, in her betrayal of your pact, imperiled all of you. I understand what you say. And yet, you cannot condemn your sister, no matter what. She chose a love. She reached out, and she found another person, and she embraced him. And she couldn't know when she did whether all the hopes of her childhood for true love, for tenderness, a soulmate for all her life, were destined for disillusion. Still, she reached out. And if we cannot embrace another, what hope is there of life? What hope is there to survive at all? And this is why love trumps all. Love is the highest law. It can be bounded by no other love of another person, man or a woman. It cannot be wrong. Does this mean that every woman must get married? No, of course not. Sometimes a woman might love another woman. Sometimes a man prefers a man. But to love, this cannot be wrong. And so Lydia, she cannot be condemned. And that's the end of it. And as for you, there will be no punishment of you either. Though you may have done wrong, there will be no justice. For the sake of a healing, for life to go on, there will be no justice. Now, Piero, it will be your job to keep this out of the hands of the courts and the judges. That much you can do. And now, you girls alone in the world, what will you do? I have to say, I wish you could stay on here with me. I would take you in and care for you as my own daughters. That would make me happy. I like a strong woman. And I like a woman who sticks with her sisters. You'll see, one day you'll find a good man. Or not. I always need a man. I myself, I no longer need a man, except of course my son Piero, who stays with me forever. So we all live here together and have come to embrace the splendid variety of life here on Earth. The good and the bad, sweet and sour, take it for what it is, the glory of life. And this is why everybody cries at weddings, out of happiness and sorrow, regret and hope combined. Thank you.